Here we go, folks. This is the Silicon Valley commute, brought to you specifically for this for your viewing pleasure. We're trying to beat the commute, actually, is what we're trying to do here. So, and we can have a little talk here as we go along. Not so bad here yet, you see. I think we may have got a slight jump on it. It's 4:08, so it's actually looking pretty civilized here. So this is the 101. Oh, gosh, it's not bad at all right now. This is extraordinary. It's Friday afternoon. Maybe people only working 4 days a week now. This is what it must be. Anyway, enjoy the sights of the Bayshore Freeway. As I just jury-rigged this camera up, it was about 28 minutes of high def. Take the Whipple Avenue exit. I'll see the... It'll get congested by Palo Alto 10 minutes. What are they talking about? Who is saying that? Beautiful day here around the bay. Now, to get to the heart of the matter, as we enjoy the scenery here, the wow has been so strong, I had troubles with it last night. The breakthrough was so great that I actually went back to music. I said, wow, don't want to do that. And that's a big mistake. And I'm paying for it because the songs are reverberating through my mind over and over and over and over and over here. It's a bad thing. So the elation was so great. I tried to step it down by transferring it over to some music. This is what I discovered, that I've been doing this my whole life. That, oh, and there's something even more important than that we could talk about. Gosh, this computer is looking really, really great right now. It's wonderful. I discovered something very, very important today. And I call it the spiritual black hole effect. And what it is there's this effort in the world to completely ignore everything spiritual, all the progress that's made, no acknowledgement whatsoever. And what happens is those who have the progress and have the milestones and all this, I was thinking of getting off on this road. Should I do that or just give you the full commute here? That it, when you have all the spiritual success on the path and nobody acknowledges it at all, as if it didn't exist, it produces a freak-out effect in your mind, and you start doubting yourself. It says, maybe I'm crazy. Maybe I'm making this up. Maybe this is what... So they're trying to create this spiritual black hole of non-acknowledgement here. This is deadly for us. I mean, this is just horrible. You know, I've had to battle against this my whole life. You have these tremendous events, and you try to tell people, and it's like nothing, you know. Like, it never happened. It doesn't exist. What are you talking about? It's an intentional tactic. Now, I've noticed this in all the, you know, the internet companies, high-tech companies. They tend to ignore religion, spiritual, you know, depth spirituality, non-dual stuff, as if it didn't exist. As if it doesn't exist. And this is across the board in society now. It's an intentional effort to make this spiritual black hole that just sucks everybody into it by refusing to acknowledge that any of this stuff exists that I've been talking about my whole life. I've been trying to keep us out of this black hole. Hey, turn to Jesus. There was a sign right there. You see that? It said, turn to Jesus. Wow, I didn't miss that. Awesome. Turn towards Jesus. Well, there's a little sign, you see, in the wilderness. So by just everybody deciding that, no, it doesn't exist, what happens? Those who are on the path tend to be dragged down into the spiritual black hole, thinking they're the ones that must be mistaken. Wow. I just saw it, you know, so clearly. I said, uh-oh. Because I was saying, where's the acknowledgement? You know, where is the acknowledgement? acknowledgement. I mean, yesterday, this video, realizing this is just all empathy training for this non-existent self, the self of the vulnerable self, thinking that we need to train to help raise this self, you know, help it grow and acknowledge it. And of course, it doesn't exist at all. There is no vulnerable self. All this is just empathy training, and seeing that was just so huge because we don't need any of this. I recognize this is the door to freedom. And so I'm waiting for some acknowledgement. No acknowledgement, you know. And so then you start thinking, wait a minute, did this really happen? You know, if a tree falls in the forest and nobody's there, nobody hears it, did it happen? This is the black hole effect. Of course it happened. Of course the tree fell, made a noise. Just because we're not around to hear it doesn't mean it didn't happen. So I'm saying, hey, how about, you know, where do I get acknowledgement? And I think this is what's happening. Well, I know this is what's happening in the world to everyone here, is they're getting pulled down by this non-acknowledgement. So I try to acknowledge, you know, everyone by the video saying, yeah, this stuff really does happen. The grace of God really is active in this world. And to try and acknowledgement. I said that Ramana Maharshi acknowledged me in the year around 2000, gave me acknowledgement, you know, and this saved my life, because I just feeling, you know, that there was no acknowledgement. I wasn't getting any acknowledgement. Now, recently I haven't gotten much acknowledgement at all, and this is a problem. As you get these huge breakthroughs, if there's no acknowledgement from you know, sources that can recognize it, then you feel like maybe I'm just on some sort of weird trip, you know, and it starts freaking you out. It's the freak out thing. So where's the acknowledgement? Where is the acknowledgement? This is huge. I'm so wowed out that I'm having trouble with the wow. It's so strong. I'm okay though. I'm struggling through it. I started listening to music, and I went to YouTube. YouTube has this new music channel, and I went to look at it, clicked on it, and there's this hideous video that starts out with, you know, just hideous reptilian-like video. And I felt so, like someone just, you know, take a dump on me. It was horrible. And so I wanted to wash that out of my system. You know, they blindsided, sucker punched us with that video. And I got to go find some good music. So I started looking for some good music. I finally found Simon and Garfunkel, was it 2012? They had a reunion, Sounds of Silence, this thing. Very, very nicely done. I said, oh, that's pretty nice. And then I said, oh, Dreamin', Blondie, let me go to that. I mean, that's just like, that'll wash it out of my system. And then next thing you know, I'm watching all these Blondie videos. Maybe the coolest band ever. Clem Burke, you know, and Debbie Harry, and the songs are just, you know, they're just epic. and I started watching, all this stuff got into me. Atomic, you know, just another epic song, and so many epic songs they did. Maybe the last great band, you know, maybe one of the best bands ever. And so that you know, that caused a problem, big problem. Well, what do you do when the elation was so strong? The elation is so strong, you want to kind of step it down a little bit. Step it down into music. So we use music to try and say, oh, you know, that my elation is coming from these songs and not from the actual insight that, you know, hey, we don't even need a body. We don't even need a world. This is all empathy training for what doesn't exist, but will never exist. So this all this training is much ado about nothing. Has no value. No value whatsoever. And see this, you say, oh my gosh, the door to freedom is opening. See, now we're starting to get into the traffic here. Yeah, it was a mirage there. I should have gone up that other street. But hey, it's okay. We're just cruising here. This has a 28-minute time limit, so it'll go beep when it's done. Now maybe I'll have to do another one. So this elation, this is the problem. So managing one's success on the path when you just have these epic breakthroughs. Two things, managing your success and... policeman. I hope they don't say, what are you doing with this camera? Well, what the heck, you know, I'm hands-free, it's not a problem. Managing success and then no acknowledgement. The problem of no acknowledgement, battling through that lack of acknowledgement. Now, other societies, cultures, historically, I mean, there was a ton of acknowledgement. A ton of it. But this culture, I saw in a dream, what it is, we're going to a black hole where there's no acknowledgement. No acknowledgement. Just, even though it's sketchy, you know, talking about God, people don't quite understand. They talk about the Holy Spirit. They don't, talking about Jesus, talking about, you know, Ramana Maharshi, talking about non-dualism, talking about acknowledgement, and just a general sense of acknowledgement buzz. Like, oh, you had a great non-dual insight. Oh, that's great. You know, tremendous. I mean, I hope I have that someday, you know. It's just simple acknowledgement. It doesn't exist. Except for, you know, a couple people here on this YouTube channel. But where do you find it? And I think all the spiritual aspects are being dragged down. I remember feeling, wow, I just can't, I won't exist if I keep, you know, thinking this way. Nobody's going to acknowledge me or any, my life. I'm going to have an unacknowledged life. This is the worry I have. Like, my whole life, if people will act like it never happened. You know, completely unacknowledged. All the efforts and insights and meetings, spiritual meetings with these great teachers, and listening to what they said and working on it. It's like it never happened. Very, very bizarre. And so in this dream, I saw that we were being led into this black hole, this like tunnel inside a rock, this big mountain. And we were going, everyone was going in there. And it was completely pitch dark. This is like a black hole, being led into a spiritual black hole. So what do we do about this? Where is the acknowledgement? I need some acknowledgement for these huge, epic. I mean, this is just absolutely managing success of this insight is just, I'm elated, you know. I've just been elated at seeing this. How do you manage this elation? He says, well, you know, just have to work here. It helps. You have to do a bunch of tough work. I'm working frantically. But yeah, it's not easy. So stay away from trying to step it down into something. This is where we get into trouble. I recognize in hindsight now, I said, oh my gosh, I've got into a lot of trouble. The elation was so strong, I didn't know what to do about it, and no one's acknowledging where it's coming from. So you say, I need to step this down into something that people acknowledge. And you say, oh yeah, I'm really so elated because I listened to this really cool song by Blondie. Oh, it's really awesome, you know. They say, oh yeah, I know, I like that song too. So, so they think your elation is coming from that. So the non-acknowledgement of our elation coming from spiritual insight, it, you know, causes us severe trouble here. This is, in hindsight, it's showing me this. How about that? It's even more elation. What is that big crane up there? What in the world is that? That's gigantic. Or is it closer than I think? Yeah. Let me see. What is all of this? So it's causing us more problems. This is the problem of the world. This is why this is such a dangerous period for all of us spiritually. And I keep saying, do something, you know, acknowledgement, you know, from the great sages, acknowledgement. We need acknowledgement to happen. And I think it's tough for us because nobody, if we have an experience, nobody will acknowledge it. And then we try to step down the elation and displace it onto something else. And then we get into real big trouble. That's why having a great teacher here would be so important. I've been saying this over and over. Vitally important. So at least we could say, well, you know, That's part of the elation is coming from the great gospel, the good news that we're getting from his teacher. And then we wouldn't have to, you know, step it down. wouldn't have to displace it, dissociate it. I've run through this problem with you know, being contacted by these great non-dual sages and then telling people, like, wow, you know, I'm having all these experiences, and they just, like, you know, I think he's going crazy, you know. And then it, well, this works on you. Gradually it works on you. And it causes us to really come a cropper, no question about it. This is why I say a spiritual culture is all important. The understanding the protocol, the spiritual culture. So it's this culture of acknowledgement of progress on the spiritual path towards realizing that, you know, there's nothing to be liberated from. There is no fixation. So there can't be a self based on fixation. It's impossible. Doesn't exist. And so we don't need to go through empathy training to try and empathize with a self that doesn't exist, can never exist. This is, and of course we're trying to psych God out by doing this, by claiming, well, we're doing all this work, so there must be such a self. It has to exist, otherwise we wouldn't be going through all this effort, right? All this empathy training. We say, of course there must be. You know, we're not crazy. This is ridiculous. And what we try to do is we make it seem more ridiculous that there isn't. Saying that there isn't a self is more ridiculous than saying there is a vulnerable self, because of all the effort we made, it'd be ridiculous to say that that all this is done for no purpose. You know, for it would be so ridiculous that we have to conclude that there must be this vulnerable self. This is the game we are playing. It's the game of one-upsmanship and ridiculousness, which is more ridiculous. You know, saying that there is no vulnerable self. Self of vulnerability, or saying that there is, you know, which is more ridiculous. And we, you know, of course, truth saying is totally ridiculous to say that there is such a vulnerable self. It can't exist. And we've done so much effort, put so much effort into pretending to prepare or cater to this self, even though it doesn't exist, that we say, well, it's just ridiculous to say that all this effort is based on nothing at all. Totally ridiculous. So it's this one-upsmanship, a game of one-upsmanship that we're engaged in here with God, actually. And we're trying so hard to fool God that we end up fooling ourselves. And so we've severely fooled ourselves. But keep in mind, we haven't fooled God at all. So everything is fine, you know. So reality is still real. No worries. Reality is still real. Well, commute is starting to tighten up, and you can see going the other direction, it's really tightened up. But this is actually really good here, because it's early. Later, it's going to be a nightmare. But this is going to be a nightmare quite soon here. Here we go. It's starting to stop. Here you go. Officially stopped. Do I want to try to make my way through the cities, or just keep, you know, be a lemming here and suffer the consequences of being a lemming? I don't know. Oh, motor, Mr. Motorcycle says I can split lanes. I don't need to slow down. So I was wondering where the next video would come from, and lo and behold, here it is. I find people kind of like these types of videos. It brings it into the here and now, and which is where we're at. And there is this spiritual black hole that the world is working on. And again, somebody told me, in where he works, he says, if I talk about God, it's except crazy. Can't do it. It's a social taboo against it. A social taboo against referencing spiritual truth. Holy Spirit, hello. You know, you can't reference the Holy Spirit. When was the last time I could reference in any to speaking to anyone Holy Spirit? Almost never. There's just a few people I can do that with. And other people, you cannot say that word because they'll think you're cuckoo. Say, hey, you're not empathizing with the vulnerable self. You know, we're you're not righteous. We're righteously working on learning, you know, training ourselves to be more sympathetic to the vulnerable self, you know, the, The vulnerable self is frightened when it hears a term like a Holy Spirit. We can't say that, use that term. I said, oh, God, yeah, sorry. Yeah, just, I know. Here we go now. Into the teeth, folks. You're seeing it firsthand. But this isn't nearly as bad as Friday, too. It's much less on Friday. Much less. I mean, this is pretty casual right here that we're dealing with. But nevertheless. And it's going to get, you know, way, 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 way worse. They are building apartment complexes everywhere. Stuffing people in like sardines here. It's another Los Angeles. Plain and simple. We've lost our bucolic paradise here, you know. It's just really, it's gone. It is absolutely gone. And trying to get out of this place, you know, on weekends is also heck. And coming back is terrible. Because everybody is trying to escape this place now. And so even getting out is terrible. So if you have money, you go to the airport, jump on an airplane and just go somewhere. Which is, a lot of people do that. Let's just take a week. Let's get away. Jump on an airplane. No traffic. They fly to some Bahamas or somewhere. Whatever. Get away from this rat race. And if you don't have the money, you're stuck in this rat race. So, grace of God, we need acknowledgement. We need acknowledgement. And, of course, that puts us in a double bind, because then we start talking about the acknowledgement. Everybody says, oh, you're not supposed to be. You're not having the, that's not the correct empathy to have. Can't do that. So, it is a double bind. But at least we're bringing this out in the open. I've been able to, you know, explain it, to define it, to clarify it. The problem. We have the severe problem. And so that helps out, I'd say, significantly. There's enough hindsight now to recognize, oh, so this is what's going on. So this is what the program is. I've been observing it the whole time, but I haven't quite clearly seen the black hole effect. That's a blackout. And this causes spiritual people to think that there's something severely wrong with them. And then they convert to, you know, secular, non-spiritual, you know, they just start disbelieving in the grace of God is what happens. They disbelieve in it. And of course, we're told in scriptures, biblical scriptures, that this end time period will be so bad that most people will, even the saints will be in danger of apostasy, you know, of losing their faith, losing the faith in the grace of God. They will be in severe danger of that. And that's the black hole effect. It's not a joke. I've had to work every day of my life to try and avoid it. And even now, I don't feel like I'm necessarily safe. No. This is how intense it is. By design, of course. It's a very sneaky. It's a classic maneuver. Psych-out maneuver. And they've done tests on that, you know, where they get somebody who's in a room and in a group, and someone's speaking the truth, and everybody else reacts like, what in the world are you talking about? You must be crazy. And eventually the person starts feeling that they're crazy, even though they're speaking just an ordinary truth. And so this is social engineering at its worst that's taking place in this world right now. And all these folks here are heavily, 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 heavily bringing it to you. Here. Silicon Valley. These are the folks that are producing all the artificial intelligence that's programmable to produce this black hole. They're working on a black hole. Absolutely, they are. You know, living here, it's a spiritual Gehenna, you know. But hey, if you can make it here, you can make it anywhere. Acknowledgement. Where's the acknowledgement? Why don't we get some acknowledgement here? We need it, we need it, we need it. I've been begging for acknowledgement for a long time. And because I seeing what the problem is, I realized, hey, we are in big trouble here. Spiritual trouble. Once you lose faith in the grace of God, then this is big trouble. How do you get it back? Especially that once you become super familiar with artificial intelligence and all that, how do you get it back? Well, it's not easy. I wouldn't think it's very easy at all. So it's super important not to lose it. And this is why I said this time is so important that we don't lose it. So what's going to happen? I don't know. Is there going to be a rapture where those who want to keep faith in the grace of God have to, you know, get out of here so they don't lose their faith? Faith is under a severe attack just by completely ignoring it. This is what they do on television everywhere. The secular society utterly ignores it. And you can say, yeah, you know, Jesus could show up and say, well, you know, I saw Jesus yesterday, and they just like pay no attention to what you said at all. You say, okay, and just, you know, next. And, you know, like, well, we don't talk about those things. We don't mention those things. That's a sign of mental illness or something. This is the game. It's a nasty game that they're playing. Take it from me. It is a vicious game. What they're implying is that you must be suffering from some severe mental illness. But it's even deeper than that. They just want to get you to convert to their... someone's trying to squeeze in here. See, there's a what I call a squeezer. Prius, not surprising. Prius squeezed by me on a road today, a very dangerous squeeze. Prius drivers are a pretty interesting lot. Very interesting. They either go real slow or real fast, like this squeezer here. you rarely just see them. Just, you know, normal drivers. They have some sort of complex. A lot of people have noticed that. So I got you on tape, you Prius squeezer. Don't worry. We're very forgiving. Oh, not bad at all here. This is wonderful. I'm beating the worst of it by far. Yeah. Wow. It's absolutely great. But we're gonna get hit here. No doubt about that. It's gonna do the tighten up here. Wow, it's like a miracle here. Where is everybody? Out of town, I guess. A lot of people have dashboard cams now. So we have got our own little impromptu dashboard cam here, talking about acknowledging, you know, acknowledgement, spiritual black hole. This is all an empathy training that is totally, has no application to whatsoever. You know, these are like an extraordinary topics to talk about, actually. Usually people have spiritual matters here, sages, that, and the acknowledgement, they get acknowledgement from them. Say, yes, yes, yeah. You know, you've seen this, and that's wonderful. You're making progress. You don't have a spiritual mentor, you know, it's pretty dominant. Wow, this is amazing. There's no traffic. What happened? Did people just, like, get raptured or something? Suddenly, from no traffic to traffic, doing the tighten up. Yeah, it was a mirage. There was a brief moment of freedom. We were breathing the air of transport freedom, and now we've gone into transport dystopia. This transport torture. Uh-oh, yeah. This is where it gets bad. There's no way to avoid it, to escape this. So, in the world, we think, oh, you know, maybe we have we're finally getting free, and then, uh-oh. It's like that, uh-oh. So, by July of 2016, it's going to be, uh-oh. You know, we have this little grace period here. And then, at some point, the black hole effect will hit people. And there'll be this collective belief that all that spiritual stuff we used to believe in, it was all nonsense. It was all a symptom of mental illness. Probably, you know, bad nutrition. You know, they'll say something like, ah, you know what, they just didn't have, you know, good medicine and didn't have good nutrition. And that's why they had these sort of aberrations, spiritual aberrations. And now that we're enlightened in this, you know, very sophisticated age, we realize that that was probably, you know, like a B3 deficiency. They'll isolate it in the brain chemistry, and they say, okay, now we'll be able to fix that. You know, they'll say, oh, isn't that wonderful? Finally, we don't have to be tormented by all these, you know, talk of, you know, of salvation, and be bothered by this continuity fear that kicks up some kind of weird fear, you know, says, oh, we got rid of it. Just make sure you take your vitamins. And that'll be it. And people will say, you know, that we're done with it. We're done. That was just a phase, you know, an archaic phase. They'll look at it like that. Like Julian James and the breakdown of the bicameral mind or something like that, where people used to hear God talking to them and say, oh yeah, that was an archaic phase. And now this last couple thousand years old, they'll say the same thing. It's like, wow, we're finally out of that. Like out of a cave, you know, we've gotten out of the cave. Meanwhile, they've walked into a black hole. You know, they say, oh, isn't it great to get out of the cave? I think it's called out of the frying pan, into the fire. Yeah. They, you know, it's slow on the uptake here. A little slow on the uptake. We're not in the cave anymore. So they're celebrating not being in the cave, and they say, well, where are we now? I don't know, but it's so different. It was so much darker. They went back deeper in the cave, you know. The idea of a cave is to get out of the cave into the light, not to go deeper into it. Beautiful day here. Gorgeous day. Wow. It's like we're so spoiled, it's hard to even comprehend. That's why all these people are here. And that's why it's too expensive to live here. For anyone. I mean, it's just going completely nuts. So, as we're making great use of our time here, aren't we? As we move along the freeway. In our commute, using our commute in the proper way, it's always difficult. I've struggled with it. You have to keep your, you know, head on a swivel. You really got to be tuned into the traffic. But, you know, it's actually easier to drive when the traffic is going slower like this. And to focus on spiritual topics. Whereas everybody's going, you know, 85, 90 miles an hour and weaving through traffic and zooming onto on-ramps, people squeezing at high rate, that's scary. But if we're just cruising at 35 miles an hour, which we're doing right now, that's not so bad. It's kind of, you could be on autopilot. Yeah, this is just extraordinary. What I'm experiencing here. I don't know, is today like a vacation day or something? I can live with this, but it's an aberration. This morning, with the traffic, was terrible. Absolutely terrible. Or was that yesterday? Maybe it was yesterday. Thursday. Yeah, it was Thursday. Oh, gosh. There's another Prius. They're everywhere. But they can't go in the diamond lane anymore. It's really weird. That was their claim to fame for a long time. But they got booted for some reason. I don't know why. I don't understand that. Just let them back in. Let the Prius back in. It's a hybrid. A hectic work week in artificial intelligence field, USA. A week of unprecedented spiritual breakthrough and unprecedented non-acknowledgement. Yeah, it's very deflating, you know, when there's no acknowledgement. I haven't even gotten good dreams. I mean, what the heck? I thought my dreams would be extraordinary. No. Certainly something going on in the dreams. That's no question about that. Seems like some, you know, really heavy, important stuff's being worked out. But there, as far as, you know, elation and bliss in the dreams, and no. So what could you do? You just have to keep working. You know, sometimes the dreams become really extraordinary, and you're enlightened during the dreams, and you see through all the problems resolved. But other times, you see just, you know, plodding through a swamp. I haven't been able to get any sort of correlation with what I pay attention to at all. With how the dreams are. It's like the dreams are on some sort of parallel line to what's, you know, surface consciousness. There's sort of a disconnect there. And so whatever happens to surface consciousness doesn't necessarily reflect immediately in dreams in the way we would, you know, expect it to. It's like a whole different realm. Dream realm. There's a waking dream and sleeping dream realm. Just so beautiful the day. Well, today was just gorgeous. Ah, the fall colors. I was at this house and I looked up and I saw this maple tree, some Japanese maple, and it was all the leaves were golden, and the sunlight was hitting it. And it was just like, it was so beautiful. I was just like stunned by it. Oh my gosh! You don't expect to see something like that. So. There's the grace of God right there. I saw this whole tree looking just golden, like golden light. You know, maybe that's, you know, foreshadowing. I hope so. You could make your own spiritual path. You have to, actually. You have to fashion it. Nobody's going to fashion it for you, necessarily, right? And so you just have to interpret. Oh, there's a lane splitter right there. You see that? It's legal. You have to make your own path as far as how you relate to, you know, glasses half full. So we just sort of put a spiritual spin on this trip here, right? And that makes you feel like, hey, yeah, I'm relating it to, I'm acknowledging my path. We have to acknowledge our own spiritual path. We don't get enough acknowledgement from the world these days at all. All right, and never have, you know, really. You get perfunctory stuff in a religious society, oh, did you go to church? But as far as the really in-depth stuff, there's never enough knowledge, unless you're really hooked up with a spiritual mentor or a tradition, a lineage, and all this kind of stuff. There might be a lot more, acknowledgement. So I've just become a practitioner of trying to interpret stuff, whatever's happening around me, in a spiritual way. My dad was great at that, really, really great. The two of us together, oh my gosh. I mean, we were just amazing as far as just noticing stuff. Hey, did you notice that? Oh, you know this, that. Oh, you noticed that? Oh, yeah. And everything, we use it to loop back to spiritual understanding. He's great at acknowledging the spiritual path that way. So I think that really helped me tremendously to keep on in some way doing this. But I've had to, go it alone. Yeah, just looking at license plates and logos, and anything to trigger something that says, hey, that reminds me of the spiritual truth. Or, oh, this gives me a heads up about something. You're always looking for little somethings that you can turn to as a reminder. It can be anything. I mean, it's just being proactive, really. And people say, well, that's a sign of mental illness. You're trying to turn things. Now, people do this all the time to remind them of what they're really interested in, right? This is just being intelligent, smart, very smart. Don't let your surroundings, be dictated to you what they mean. You put your meaning on the surroundings and the events and stuff. You put your own meaning on it in terms of a reminder. That's why I'm able to do videos. You go out and you see stuff and say, hey, I'm going to put this in a video. This is the spin I'm going to put on it. This is what's called creativity. This is very positive creativity, reminding oneself of spiritual truth is very, very powerful, effective practice. Super creativity and intelligence. Level 10. There's a truck that says level 10, building at the highest level. See, I look at that. And say, hey, that's what we're doing right here. We're considering. We're in doing inquiry at the highest level, level 10. So there's a perfect example of what I'm talking about. So as I'm driving here, I'm looking. I'm aware of what's going on and seeing if something will catch my attention that will be a positive reinforcement. Practice positive reinforcement. Don't let what's going on try to assign meaning to you. You say, I'll assign the meaning. I see that sign. Oh, that's the meaning it has for me. Problem with artificial intelligence is we're trying to get meaning assigned to everyone from artificial intelligence, saying this is the meaning this has, as if there's some intrinsic meaning to symbols. There really isn't. Symbols are really fundamentally arbitrary. We give them all the meaning that they have for us. So the idea that there's some just symbols that have some sort of ultimate meaning that a programmer can program to artificial intelligence, and this is what we're all supposed to take as the meaning of this. This is like a black hole. It's up. Oh, Holy Spirit, I think. That bird, maybe not. Maybe that was not the logo of the Holy Spirit. Yeah. This is the danger, right? Well, you'll be called that you're insane if you don't apply the meaning to these symbols that artificial intelligence says, well, everybody does. This is why it's all programmed this way, because we know what the meaning is. Who knows? The programmer? Do you trust that? We're free. What does white mean to someone? The white truck there, what does it mean? Well, it could be lane splitter. What does that mean? Freedom. It can mean freedom. There's another one. Someone can say, well, that means, taking advantage. You can put a negative connotation. You can put a positive connotation on it. It happened to me today. I was doing something, and someone just put this very negative connotation on something I was doing very positive. I had a very positive connotation. They put a completely negative spin on it. It's like, what? So we are going into the belly of the beast. artificial intelligence is bringing us into this black hole. Program. Everything's going to be programmed. This is the meaning it has for you. Don't think for yourself. Be a good little robot. We're becoming robotic. People are becoming robotic. Their capability of this wonderful stream of consciousness, free association, they're losing that ability. I don't find any people anymore. I used to have my parents' generation. You could find people who would do that. And we were so good at the stream of consciousness, free association. We just enjoy it. It's like the most enjoyable way to spend your time. It's just tremendous, you know. And we were brought up to think creatively. My dad was actually a teacher of creative education, how to make education much more creative and intuitive. That he was an expert in that. So I had that, upbringing, what that allowed for that. Somewhat. But, everybody, society, cracked down. They wanted in the classroom. Oh, sure, in the classroom you can do it, but outside the classroom? No, you got to be a good little corporate robot. So, unfortunately, this is the case. And you just don't get those. Rare is it that people can look at something and attach this really beautiful, sublime meaning to it, just because they want to. And keep flowing with the free association. I mean, I miss that. That's very spiritual way of functioning. And it's going extinct. Going the way of the dodo bird. So we're getting a little slow down here, but this is not bad at all. We missed the worst of it. Absolutely, we did. But fine. It's getting dark soon, isn't it? 4:55. Oh my gosh. It's gonna be dark by 5. Can you play golf at 5 o'clock? Now? I don't know. Cards in by 4:30, folks. I don't know if I can do that. It's still light enough to see your golf ball. I was driving down a street today through a city, and there's this golf course on the left behind this fence, and all the ivy was kind of dying for winter. This vegetation that usually keeps you from seeing it. I was able to see through the fence, and I've never seen this golf course before. I've been down this road many, many times, never seen it. It's like, wow, look at this beautiful golf course behind this tall fence that normally you don't even know it's there. I'm able to see through the fence and is able to see it kind of partially, the whole golf course there, and many fairways, and I just say, oh wow, right in the middle of this city there's this beautiful golf course I didn't even know it was there. Not even sure what golf course it is. I have to check that out. And so that I interpreted that as saying I'm able to start seeing through the fence now, seeing through the defenses to what? Garden land, this beautiful death-free realm. That this probably a private golf course that you can't get on the golf course unless you get invited. I was able to now, see through. You're not supposed to be able to see it. I was able to see it. So I give this huge positive, spin to this experience. So there's another great example of how to put positive spin on your experiencing. Reinforce, acknowledgement. Do self-acknowledge. Acknowledge your own progress, because nobody's going to do it for you in this world. I mean, parents aren't doing it at all anymore. Teachers? No. Employees? No. Who? Who is giving acknowledgement to this type of spiritual path of endeavor of putting, acknowledging your own progress, putting positive spiritual spin on everything as much as you can? All of what we're doing, who is acknowledging it in society and institutionally? The government? Okay, no charities? No. Where do you get it? Start going through a list and you find out nobody. Even your friends say, hey, tone it down. So, gargantuan problem. Catastrophic. We'll see what happens. We'll see. The more we realize how bad the situation is, the more we can tune into to the remedy. The remedy may be quite extraordinary, and we were thinking, like, well, we don't really need that extraordinary of a remedy. That's a little bit, you know, too much. And maybe we're saying, maybe it's not too much. Maybe it's not too much here. Because there is just no acknowledgement at all for the kind of spiritual way, walking the way in spirit. No acknowledgement here. You're stuffed in. All right. Well, we got a battery exhaustion issue here. So I changed the battery on the fly here. Going in this, you know, slow traffic, able to do that, because everybody's behaving themselves, which is unusual. So there's a lot of greats going on right here, right now. Ah, beautiful, huh? California, November, whatever, 13th, Friday the 13th, actually, today, isn't it? Friday the 13th. So, a spare battery. How great is that? It's a blessing to be able to travel at this speed. This never happens. So it's an anomaly here. That's great. I take this, spin this in a positive way. God is clearing it out for us somehow, you know. We're able to make progress that we didn't expect at this time. So there's a perfect example. Put positive spin on your experiencing. Put faith in the grace of God. This is what we're losing in this world. We're saying we don't need the grace of God. We got artificial intelligence that's more reliable. No, it is not. It is not. It's more robotic. And it's the lazy person's way. I mean, it's a lazy way. It's the way of laziness. There's not calling on inspiration. You know, you're not trying to call on our, you know, inspiration. I need to be inspired. I need to be inspired. I need to be inspired. And it doesn't lead you out of the black hole at all. It pulls you into it more and more and more. Bro, it's not better in any way. Possibly say this. Everybody, I don't know, what is this? Everybody seems subdued, not frantic. Maybe it's because it's Friday, I don't know. Or maybe because it's not so bad. Everybody's, we're just blessed here somehow at this Friday the 13th. This is quite extraordinary. This is not the ordinary experience here of commute. Putting our attention on God, and somehow this got smoothed out. Nobody's been trying to jam their way in except that one little Prius did. But that's what they do. But everybody else is right. They're just staying in their lanes, and all this lane switching, there's not all this franticness taking place at all. It's just everybody says, oh, we'll just relax here. Moving on down the road. It's getting pretty dark now. What time is it? After 5 o'clock. Okay. So we're just traveling. Traveling on home, and our way is being made smooth. This is what we have to have faith in. Our way is being made smooth. Just have patience. It's moving. Going to get there. Just have faith in the grace of God. So, manage success, manage your success, manage your success. And just keep working at it. You know, be artful about it. Be intuitive about it. Use opportunities. Try to keep generating opportunities. Try to keep making excuses, you know. Try to find an excuse to succeed. Use the excuses that you have to succeed. This is what is so crucial. While we're going slow, oh, great excuse. Maybe I could, you know, do this taping. Whatever the situation, look for, okay, how can I use this as a great excuse to focusing on spiritual truth? Most people are robotically incapable of doing that right now. They don't even know what you're talking about. They say, you're weird. You know, it's weird. I know what this is a situation for. It's not for that. You know, as if they know, you know, there's some set situation. You walk into a restaurant, well, this is how we're supposed to think now. We're in a commute. We're supposed to be upset and uptight. No, we're doing this wonderful taping. This is how I see it. You know, so there's a multiplicity. You know, there's really an infinite array of how we could use this situation. We could be singing. We could be daydreaming. We could listen to the radio. Actually, you know, so on. We could be looking at the trees. We could be counting cars. Look at the license plates. And creativity would just show us, you know, endless opportunities of how do we look at this. We could just enjoying the colors of the cars or the red lights. So, keep going. Give yourself acknowledgement. Give yourself acknowledgement. And that's the way. And that's the commute.